Chapter 10, A Case Study, Outpouring in Terre Haute, Indiana. The challenge that faces me in this chapter is writing a case study of an outpouring while it is still occurring. This may affect perspective, but I write, as always, from my vantage point. My wife and I were invited to preach a three-day meeting at Cross Tabernacle in Terre Haute, Indiana, in August of 2010. I had preached a seven-week meeting at that church in 1997, and during that time, I had become acquainted with Keith Taylor, a staff evangelist, who now serves as the pastor of the church. It was he who invited us to minister at his church. Cross Tabernacle has long had a reputation for experiencing moves of God. If it is not the oldest Pentecostal church in the Wabash Valley, it is considered the mother church for a number of the Pentecostal churches there. For years, it has hosted events where it has invited smaller churches to participate simply because it has the facilities, people, and passion for doing so. Cross Tabernacle could and would bring in nationally known speakers that other local churches might have found difficult to host. The pastor has long been perceived as a spiritual leader, not only in his city, but in his state as well. He served as a member of the executive leadership of his state's denomination. On the third day of the scheduled three-day meeting, Pastor Taylor asked me if I would be willing to stay one more day. And after the service on the fourth day, he asked if we could stay one more day again. I remember observing that the depth of the meeting after 5 days seemed to me to be much greater than after the 7 weeks in 1997. On the Friday, we flew to Germany to speak at a conference. Keith took his pastoral staff and drove to Mobile, Alabama to attend the Bay of the Spirit revival that had broken out there. When Keith walked in the door of that meeting, he told the Lord he felt the same type of presence we had been experiencing in the meetings in Terre Haute. The Lord's response was to tell him there were two differences. The first had to do with the spirit of expectation. The Lord emphasized to Keith that people walked into the Bay of the Spirit with great expectations, but they did not walk into Cross Tabernacle with the same expectations. Secondly, the Lord spoke to him about a strong religious spirit that was dominant in Terre Haute. After this, the Lord indicated that in the third service, Keith would know if this was the season he was looking for. Keith rang me in Germany and asked if we would consider returning to Terre Haute. He made it clear that he was not sure that I would preach. He simply wanted me to be in that service because he knew of no one else who had been in as many extended meetings as we had, and he wanted my take on what I felt. In perhaps one of the greater understatements of my life, I rang two pastors we were scheduled to be with in New Zealand and asked them if they would be willing to release me from my commitment and allow me to reschedule them at a later time. I remember saying to them, "This is going to sound strange, but I'm going to ask you to release me so I can go sit in a church on a Sunday morning." I went on to say, "I can only say I have this gut-level sense that if I do not do this, I will regret it." So on that Sunday in September of 2010, Linda and I found a place on the front row next to Keith and Karen Taylor and never left that spot. In retrospect, one did not need a great deal of spiritual insight that morning to realize something significant was happening. On that day, Keith Taylor did the actual preaching. He waited until after the usual dismissal time to call the church to a time of response. I think well over 90% of the congregation rushed to the altar. It was nearly 2 p.m. before the last of the congregation left there. Somewhere around that time, Keith announced services would be held the next night. And these continued for the next 2 weeks. After this, a church wedding and a statewide denominational event requiring the participation of the pastor obliged us to set meetings aside for 1 week. The first service after that break was incredibly intense. It was just like we had not taken a break at all. At that point, we recognized something unusual was taking place. We determined we would not wear out the staff of the church, nor the people. For the next month, services were held Wednesday through Friday and Sunday. After that month, another adjustment was made. The Wednesday service was returned to the church for a more normal schedule. The intent was to provide opportunity for discipleship to happen. Wednesday had long been the night of discipleship emphasis at Cross Tabernacle. In addition to youth ministry, the church was running groups for men and women, boys and girls, and a school of ministry. Thursday night, Friday night, and Sunday nights were held for several months. The emphasis was primarily on souls. On Sunday mornings, Linda and I began to minister in other churches in the area. The intent was twofold. First, it was to spread the fire to other churches within a three-hour drive, and second, to take some financial pressure off of the Terre Haute Church. After several months of the above schedule, we adjusted that schedule to Friday and Sunday nights. Every revival we have preached has been different. There are certain things we have learned in all of them. This one has certainly been a journey. A journey into the fivefold ministries of the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 4:11. A few weeks into the meeting, we were joined by Fred Aguilar. I had known Fred for over 25 years. We had both pastored First Assembly of God in Paris, Illinois. I had preached in his churches. He'd also served as an evangelist and served as a presbyter of the Assemblies of God for his part of the state of Indiana. When Fred walked into Cross Tabernacle that night, I said to him, "Fred, I've been waiting for you." A few minutes later, Keith Taylor said the same thing to him. Fred recognized it was more than him. It was what he represented. As a boy, growing up in Chicago, he attended a church that experienced a three-year revival. Pastors would come from across the nation to the church, where they would tell the pastor they had come for a prophetic word. The pastor would say, "I do not have a prophetic word for you, but if you will be in the meeting tonight, one of our children will have one." As a 10-year-old boy, Fred was used by God to read the mail of these men of God. They began to call him the Little Prophet. After that revival closed, due, as Fred told us, to pride, which had become a huge issue, he went through something of a dark season. Later, he was restored to the kingdom of God, where he served as a pastor, statewide youth director for his denomination, itinerant preacher, and the like. I knew that Fred carried a special anointing, but I did not understand his background. About 18 months before the outpouring broke out in Terre Haute, Fred underwent surgery. It went so badly that at one point it looked like he would not survive. But two of his sons in ministry stopped by his room to tell him they had a word from God for him. He would live and not die. His finest hour was still to come. Then during the time of recovering, the Lord gave him a vision. He was asking the Lord about some unfulfilled prophetic visions God had given him 50 years earlier. And in response to his questions, the Holy Spirit said, "I am preparing a man to lead a revival in Indiana and beyond." The face of Keith Taylor then appeared in that vision. Fred had known Keith for years, since the time they served as staff evangelists out of the same church. The only person Fred shared this revelation with was his wife, but he began to pray into it. When he heard something had broken out in Terre Haute, he sensed God say to him, "This is it. This is what I told you was coming." Fred told me, "I knew the types of meetings you and Linda had been having, and I knew what God had showed me about Keith Taylor." When Fred stepped into the meetings, all the prophetic anointing he had known was restored to him. Often, I would say to Fred, "I believe God has given you a prophetic word for that person." Fred would feel nothing initially, but as soon as he would step in front of that person, the prophetic word would flow. One night, I watched something happen to him. When I inquired what he was experiencing, he told me, "The anointing I had as a boy just returned." Within a few weeks, Fred was joined by Kenny Knight, the pastor of a church in Paris, Illinois. I had known him for over 35 years. He has long been a one-man spiritual wrecking crew. God has used him in the word of knowledge, prophecy, and healing for years. Together, these two men modeled how to be prophets in a move of God. They were not presumptive nor pushy, but we began to recognize what I called the look. When I would ask either of them if he had a prophetic word, they would acknowledge they did, but would always say, "Whenever." In other words, when you feel the time is right, I will share the word the Lord has given me. Kenny in particular would be used in a word of knowledge, and often these words of knowledge had to do with healing. To be blunt, sometimes the revelation he was given was so specific and potentially embarrassing, we were sure no one would respond to it. But then the altars would begin to fill. In the following months and years, these two men were joined by others with a prophetic mantle: Jim Fox, Josh Hubble, Brother Zimmerman, and others. Additionally, the outpouring would be recognized by or visited by recognized prophets from other places. The ministry of Graham Renoff, a prophetic pastor from New Zealand, had a huge impact on both the release of the prophetic in the house and his behind-the-scenes role of counsel to outpouring. Pastors may be beyond calculation. As the outpouring developed, my role went from being the evangelist to often being a teacher as well. As one visiting missionary told me, "I love this outpouring. I love watching the power of God demonstrated throughout the service." Then you stand up and in about 15 minutes give us a biblical explanation of what we just experienced. She remarked how safe she felt as she watched Keith Taylor, pastor, Fred Aguilar, prophet, and me, evangelist teacher, form a holy huddle on the stage. She knew we were checking out what the others sensed. We had no idea the Lord was going to continue to develop the fivefold ministry in this way. We never set out to model anything. We were just seeking to follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit in each service. At one point, we invited Seth Fawcett, the lead pastor of Hope Center in Lower Hutt from New Zealand, to speak. He leads both the church where Graham Rennes served and is the recognized leader of the Partners in Ministry, a network of Hutt Valley pastors. He is recognized locally as an apostle and is also recognized that way by the Hope Center network that has churches in New Zealand, USA, and Europe. It became increasingly clear to other leaders in the Terre Haute area that Keith Taylor was being given an apostolic mantle. This title was not something he gravitated toward. Indeed, he still struggles with the title. On one occasion, I passed along the following counsel from Seth. The anointing for the apostolic function increased when I embraced the responsibility of the office. Fivefold ministry is not to be considered a title to be grasped, but a function to flow in. We came to realize a fivefold ministry comes out of relationships. Teaching, good teaching, abounds about each of the offices, so we have not developed a lot of new material. During this outpouring, we are learning how we relate to one another and flow together. Honor is significant. We are not interested in flattery, but we do seek to give genuine honor to those we minister with. Sometimes that means taking a step back so someone else can take a step forward. Outsiders were actually the first to observe how the fivefold ministry of the Holy Spirit was functioning in the outpouring. We had not intentionally set out to function as a fivefold team. We were just flowing as the Spirit led. In hindsight, we can see how the mixes of the gifts were operating together. In a recent conference, where a dozen or so outpouring leaders were sharing, a repeated expression occurred. More than one observed that when they were ministering now, without other members of the outpouring being present, they felt naked. We have come to appreciate the way the Lord uses the others. We have come to trust the Holy Spirit in the lives of others. The reality is, most Pentecostal preachers may function in various giftings at various times. The Holy Spirit enables us to be whatever we need to be at a particular time. However, we recognize some carry a stronger anointing than we do in certain areas. Before the prophets arrived at Terre Haute, I often prophesied, and God can still use me that way. But I rarely prophesy there now. The A team has arrived, so the B team is not needed. I was approached at a conference by the pastor of a Baptist church. Would I pray for two of his deacons to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit? I carried a fair amount of administrative work in that conference, but I could have prayed for these deacons and they would have received. However, I pointed the pastor to Jim Fox, one of the outpouring preachers who sees a higher percentage of people filled with the Spirit than I do. I suggested he go to Jim and tell him I had sent him. An appointment was set, and in a few minutes, both deacons received a prayer language. We honor each other by allowing them to minister. We serve the King, and we serve each other. How does this work out in an outpouring service at Terre Haute? Apostle Pastor Keith Taylor is in charge. We submit to him. At the same time, he is very open to other members of the fivefold group. Unless a guest speaker has been announced, I do most of the preaching at the outpouring, and I come prepared accordingly. However, it is not unusual for a Holy Spirit intervention to adjust the meeting. We may sense one of the prophets has a word, or they may submit a word for our consideration. It is not unusual for them to submit a word to me. Keith may ask one of the teachers to share a tidbit, or he may do it himself. Altar ministry may flow out of either a prophetic word or the preached word. In either event, most altar ministry will involve the local cross-tabernacle prayer team and or the fivefold outpouring preachers in attendance at the meeting. Souls are always a high priority. Personal ministry time usually occurs. God's manifest presence has continued to set the outpouring apart from just a church meeting. One example of flowing together in fivefold ministry occurred in Baguio, Philippines, where the outpouring team was leading evangelistic meetings. Randall Burton, the apostle pastor from Northview Church in Columbus, Indiana, was preaching. At the close of his message, without warning, he called me to the stage to give a salvation altar call. Over 400 responded to that invitation. Later, Prophet Fred Aguilar simply said, "We understand you carry an anointing for the salvation invitation that we do not carry." Relationship, flow, honor, trust are key words in the developing fivefold ministry. We do not claim to be the final word on this. We are growing together with the desire to see His kingdom extended. In a recent conversation with Keith Taylor, he observed that the whole concept of fivefold ministry is revolutionizing his church. Children's ministry, music ministry, and youth ministry are all beginning to take on a fivefold team look. The Superman concept is being replaced with a team approach. An apostle is still in place, but the flow is more through a team of committed followers of Jesus. The role of prayer. During the early weeks of the outpouring, we were joined by Marvin Adams, who served as the leader of a house of prayer. After a few minutes of sitting next to me, he turned to me and said, "Count me in. I recognize this." I discovered that during the 1990s, he had been on staff at a church in the Chicago area that had been significantly touched by the Toronto outpouring. For several years, he had been involved with the International House of Prayer in Kansas City. So he was both a revivalist and a prayer movement participant. For the next 2 to 3 years, the House of Prayer in Terre Haute became a significant intercessor for us personally and for the outpouring. The location of their building was not far from where Linda and I were being housed, so it was not unusual for us to slip into a prayer session. At its peak, this House of Prayer was praying nearly 12 hours a day. At first, we would remain incognito. Eventually, we could no longer do that. So while Marvin respected our privacy, they would also often pray for us when we were in attendance. During that season, they outgrew their facilities twice. Once a month, we relocated the outpouring service to their facilities. Their building would be packed as people came from many different congregations to pray. Those meetings would be led by a combination of their team and the leadership of the outpouring. Actually, the meetings were being led by the Holy Spirit. There was no official order of service. We simply joined together and allowed the Spirit to lead. Often, I would serve as an almost secret clearinghouse for those who had a sense of direction or input for those prayer gatherings. This unique prayer partnership was significant for both the local church and the larger city. They served as primary intercessors until God increased the level of intercession within Christ's tabernacle itself. Even in revival, things change. Eventually, that prayer ministry felt led to a new focus, and its director was led by God to relocate to another city and plant a prayer ministry there. I will forever be grateful for the season with them. Local pastors in Terre Haute have prayed together for many years. Every Wednesday morning, a group of evangelical and Pentecostal pastors come together to pray. They have been doing this for over 15 years at this writing. This group is a part of the larger ministerial group within the city. That group also prays together. Most of the local preachers who are a part of the outpouring participate in both of these prayer groups. Additionally, they meet together every Thursday morning to pray, prophesy, and otherwise minister to each other and discuss outpouring-related themes. Terre Haute is also the home city for a national prayer ministry led by David Butts, who is a part of the National Day of Prayer team. Initially, the House of Prayer hosted the Thursday morning group. But after that season ended, another pastor opened his place for the group to meet and pray. Intercessor prayer has not been without its problems. I think it'd be fair to say the Brownsville revival brought intercession out of the closet for many churches. In some places, this was hugely significant, while in other places, it was problematic. Intercessors, tragically, have been known to split churches. This checkered history has made pastors cautious regarding the developing of intercessors in their churches. We knew the outpouring in Terre Haute could not depend solely upon the prayer of the International House of Prayer team located in Terre Haute. Indeed, God began to raise up a team of intercessors within Christ Tabernacle. Initially, it was handpicked by the church pastor and functioned solely on Facebook. But when he felt the time was right, the team began to have face-to-face meetings. God had prepared a lady within the church to help facilitate that team. In addition to that group, which still functions in the shadows, the church has a Sunday morning 9 a.m. prayer service and a Tuesday morning prayer service. As one national prayer ministry moved off the scene, as far as outpouring is concerned, another moved in. The Lord sent a seasoned couple, Brian and Denise Shaw, back to Terre Haute after they had ministered for years alongside national ministries in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Branson, Missouri. In addition to participating in the pastor's prayer groups, they have begun a Saturday school of prayer that rotates among several churches who are a part of the outpouring. They have intensified their prayer ministry in the city. At this writing, their ministry is expanding both within the city, the larger outpouring circle, and beyond. Concentric circles. I have watched what I describe as concentric circles develop within the outpouring. Initially, this was a single church revival. While every department and age group within the church was significantly touched, at one point, youth group attendance was up 500%. The pastor observed the impact was particularly significant for those aged 35 and below. This group had heard about revival, but had little personal experience with it. I've often heard it said, 20s and 30s are not interested in revival. I can only say that has not been our experience in Terre Haute. They signed on big time. And now their children are growing up as Children of the Outpouring. As reports began to filter out, regional churches and or pastors began to participate. Randall Burton and many from his church would drive 2 hours to attend the services. Now his own church has been in an outpouring for 5+ years. Kenny Knight began to bring his people from Paris, Illinois, which is about 30 minutes away by car. Orlando pastors and Assemblies of God Church. Kenny pastors a Word of Faith church. Marvin McCormick followed my mother as a pastor of an evangelical church about an hour north of Terre Haute. He began attending regularly with my mother and a group of hungry people. People from Robinson, Illinois, about an hour south, began to attend. The internet played a large role. Cross Tabernacle has been live streaming their services for years. Some services have been viewed by several thousand people. In the early months of the outpouring, we received reports from the Panera ladies from Ohio. Two ladies were going to Panera Bread so they could go online and watch the services. I received testimonies from as far as New Zealand and the Philippines of people who were watching online. Pastors within the state of Indiana began watching, and at least one of these reported being healed while participating in a service online. At one point, Carrie Robertson, who had served as the senior associate pastor of the Brownsville Revival, shared his belief that God had tossed a pebble into the middle of the USA, and the ripple effects were going to be much larger than we realized. What had begun as a local church revival was now impacting hungry people from the region. Then the impact began to move to the local pastors. Several began to attend services on a regular basis. The Lord told one hungry pastor he was going to send him to a city of revival. Shortly after that, he was invited to pastor in Terre Haute. They had become outpouring fixtures. One of the staff pastors from Cross Tabernacle was invited to pastor Victory Christian Center on the east side of Terre Haute. That church has now been impacted by the outpouring. His pastoral team is a part of the larger outpouring team. That church conducts an annual tent outreach where outpouring preachers preach. The local teen challenge director made outpouring attendance a requirement for its residents. So many lives have been transformed. That director is now pastoring a church in a city about 3 hours south of Terre Haute. There are early indicators of something significant developing in that city. In any given outpouring service, 15 to 50 preachers will show up. Relationships are developing. Many of them are now preaching for each other. In a recent conference, at least 100 preachers were in one service, transforming the preacher. In fact, the transformation of preachers and the developing of fivefold relationships is one of the biggest stories of the outpouring. Several preachers have personally thanked me for the outpouring and its impact upon their personal lives and ministries. As a result of the outpouring, preaching schedules are more filled than ever before for some preachers. Both regional and now international ministry has developed for a number of preachers connected to the outpouring. One found himself preaching a 6-month revival in southern Illinois. During that season, he told me that it was his experience across Tabernacle that enabled him to lead that revival. I will love to point to a specific sermon I preached to transform the lives and ministries of these preachers. The reality is I cannot do that. The transformation came as they stood night after night at the altar in the presence of God. I believe It was the manifest presence of God more than anything else that contributed to the transformation of these preachers. Additionally, relationships are growing between them. We are probably too early in this season of revival to know where it is going to go, but one leader from the state of Missouri who is being impacted by the Terre Haute outpouring has called it the most life-changing thing he has ever been a part of. Outpourings must include outreaches and hubs of revival. One of the concerns of past revivals has been that many are inward-focused. One pastor of a church in the Midwest that experienced revival in the 1990s indicated its demise was connected to the fact they turned it inward rather than outward. God's purpose for revival has always been the lost. One missionary asked me how the Terre Haute revival was impacting evangelism. First, Cross Tabernacle has always been evangelistic. Outreach has always been a part of the church. They participate in citywide parades. They do a Joy dishwashing soap distribution in poor neighborhoods annually. The annual Single Parents Christmas event ministers to single parents and children. They do events in neighborhood parks. Feeding of the poor and disadvantaged is a part of what they do. For nearly a dozen years, I have been connected to a conference near Chicago, Illinois, where for most of this time, I served as its co-host. About 3 or 4 years ago, outpouring preachers began attending this conference. The theme of the conference for the past several years has been the glory. As the outpouring preachers began attending this conference, cross-pollination began to occur. Dr. James Horvath, host of the conference, leads Calvary Lighthouse Church in Rochelle, Illinois. For years, he has been doing citywide evangelistic crusades in the Philippines. A partnership developed between the Road to Glory Conference and the Outpouring. In 2015, the Outpouring team joined with Dr. James Horvath in doing citywide crusades in the Philippines. We participated in simultaneous crusades in multiple sites in Manila and then in multiple cities. The reports are that scores of thousands of people met Jesus. In 2016, the team returned to the Philippines to minister specifically to the pastors of Baguio. As I write this, the team is in the planning stages of a similar event in Northern Ireland. Plans are to do simultaneous events across Ireland and then close with a huge outreach in Belfast. Cross Tabernacle itself took a team from the church to assist in evangelizing First Nations people in the southwest of the USA. The Revive Indiana team also came to Terre Haute. Its stress on personal evangelism blended well with what God was doing in the city. Teams from the outpouring still go out into the city on nearly a weekly basis. Relationships between churches have also been developing. Some are calling these churches hubs of revival. A clear relationship developed between Cross Tabernacle in Terre Haute and Northview Church in Columbus, Indiana. Parishioners began attending outpouring services held in the other church. Rochelle, Illinois became another hub. Conferences at one church were attended by people from all three churches. Input from and relationship with Belfast, Northern Ireland has created a relationship with another hub church. Several other churches are relating at some level to the outpouring in Terre Haute. I am hesitant to even begin mentioning other cities and churches for fear I will overlook some. Outpouring preachers have ministered in hungry churches across Indiana and, to a lesser extent, surrounding states. Some of these cities and churches appear to be in the early stages of something significant. However, it is too early to know for certain how far this outpouring may go. Prophecies continue to suggest we have not seen anything yet. By nature, I am somewhat conservative, so I am more prepared to report than project. But this has become the biggest thing I have personally been involved with. My eschatology allows for a last days revival. My heart burns for even more. We rejoice in reports from other places. We welcome the Holy Spirit. I believe you welcome Him too. You can order your copy from our website, MikeLivengoodMinistries.com, or in New Zealand, you can order it from doorkeepersnewzealand.org. The book can be ordered by mail as well. The U.S. address is P.O. Box 1455, Danville, Illinois, 61834-1455. And in New Zealand, the address is Doorkeepers NZ at P.O. Box 31655, Lower Hutt, 5040. Additionally, the book can be ordered at Amazon.com.